So here we are going to practice how to do a single sample t-test in SPSS. And so one thing you want to notice when you're doing a single sample t is that you really only need one column of data. So I have a student's SAT score put into this column, and the way to set up single sample t-tests is to have each person gets their own unique row, so each line is a participant score, and each column is its own set of data. And so we don't want to write them going across, or SPSS won't run. So I've got every participant in their own row, one column of data, and I want to do a single sample t-test. So single sample t-tests are for when you have one sample of participants, hence one column, and a known population mean. So in this example, we're going to compare a school's set of SAT scores to a known average to see if their scores are higher or lower. So what you want to do is go to Analyze, and then Compare Means, and it's listed under one sample T. Those are the same thing. Single sample, one sample, same thing. Click on that. Remember, everything in SPSS, if it's on the left, it's not getting analyzed. If it's on the right, it is. So I'm going to move that over to the right. Here under test value, this is probably the most important part. So test value is where you're going to stick the population mean or mu. And so if you forget to do this, you'll get really big t-test numbers sometimes. Sometimes you'll get really small numbers. It depends on what your population mean and your scale is like. But unless you actually want to test against zero, you want to make sure you change this number. So we're going to say the population mean is 1250 for the SAT. Another thing you can do is if you click on options, you can get different confidence intervals. So let's say you wanted to do a 99% confidence interval instead of a 95, you can change that here. So I'm going to hit continue, I'm going to leave that alone. But really make sure you change this test value number. And then hit OK. Okay, so this is the one sample T output. It gives you N, so the number of participants in your study that it ran, the mean for that column, so 1370, so it's 1370 different from 1250 is what we're asking. It tells me the standard deviation, so 100 points, but this is a big scale, so that's not too crazy. And the standard error of the mean. Okay, so this is usually listed as S or SD in undergrad statistics books. This one's usually listed as either SE or SM for standard error of the mean. Okay. So these are the type of statistics you might report. And then in the one sample box down here, you have all of the hypothesis testing action. So I have my T value, my degrees of freedom. Remember for one sample T, that is N minus one. The two-tailed significance level, which is my actual p-value. The mean difference between my sample mean and my population mean, and then it actually gives you a confidence interval of the difference score. It does not give you a confidence interval of the mean, but what you can do is take the mean plus and minus the standard error with a cutoff t-value. Okay. And so if I wanted to write this t-test up, what I can do is, take all the relevant values from here and write them up in APA style is what we're doing here. All right. So if I wanted to say our students have a score of 1370, okay, so I would list the mean as M, and all statistics letters are in italics in APA. And then I could list the standard deviation as 112.68. Sometimes books listed as S. It's more traditional for undergraduate books to use S, but if you're reporting an APA, like writing it up for a journal, I think I see SD a little more. You also could list standard error, so 29.09. You'll notice I'm doing everything in two decimals. Or SM. Get that little thing there. 2909. And now when you list these in your write-up, you want to pick one of the standard deviation types. So don't really list both because you've told people, hopefully in your methods section, how many participants there are, so like people can convert back and forth, but usually you'll pick one of those, so standard deviation or standard error. You don't normally see both. To write up the t-test, you do lowercase t, you list the degrees of freedom, and then you list t, and then you'll list the actual p-value. So it's listed as sig in the SPSS. And then I'm going to argue to always list some form of effect size. So I'm going to do Cohen's d, and I can show you how to calculate that in moat. So from what we have right here, I have t of 14 degrees of freedom is 4.13. Actual p-value is 0.001. And then I can calculate the effect size. So moat is a free program put out by our research lab. It's available at aggieerin.com/moat, aggieerin.com/moat. There's also a video on this YouTube channel on how to use this program. But what it does is it'll calculate different effect sizes for you, especially if you're not familiar with the formulas or you're just like me and don't want to do the math by hand. But for single sample t, it's actually pretty easy. It's just mean over standard deviation here, so m over SD. Okay. There's a whole video on how to do these for each of the different effect size types if you would rather just look at that. For single sample t, I'm going to select under measures, single sample t. Okay. So then I'm going to enter the sample mean, so 1370, the population mean, 1250, and then the sample standard deviation, which I can get from here, 112.68. Oops, wrong spot. And that's going to give me a standard error. You'll notice that they don't match. Well, that's because I haven't entered n. So you always have to enter n. So 15. Now my degrees of freedom match. My sample standard error will match. And actually, t will also match. So you can get most of the information that you need from this window. Now, it's not perfect because I only entered two decimals for standard error, but two decimals are usually considered pretty good. And it tells me that my Cohen's d value, so I'm going to look here, is 1.06. That's considered a large effect size. And it also gives me the lower and upper bound. We wrote this program for meta-analyses, so you don't want to use those as your confidence interval because that's the confidence interval for d and not for m. Alright, so that is how you can calculate a single sample t-test and include all of the values listed up in APA style.